seat and let's start with the prep.
Why not?
God Almighty, help me to be used by you, God, to really help us understand just that Satan is the enemy, that his schemes are nothing new, God. We need to learn how to recognize them. Help me project this truth and also the truth of what happened to my best ability. You be glorified in Jesus' name. Amen. So today I'm actually going to talk about why the kingdom split. There have been many splits recorded in the Bible. Satan tempted Eve with false doctrine, getting her not only to doubt God's word, but to disobey God's word. Her leader, Adam, stood by and did nothing. As a result, disaster ensued. They were kicked out of paradise. Here we understand that Eve wasn't the enemy. Satan was the enemy. We must always remember, ultimately, that Satan is our enemy, not the person Satan tempts and then falls. Although some splits do lead to people becoming enemies of God, as in the case with the Moabites and the Edomites. There have been many splits in the Bible. There was a split between Cain and Abel, which split God's kingdom at the time, because Cain then went off, Seth rose up, and you had God's people, and then you had Cain. You think about how Abel was the sold out one, Cain was the one that didn't want to be sold out, and then rather than repent, got bitter. Lot split off from Abraham. The servants were quarreling, and rather than being brought to complete unity, as Jesus teaches in John 17:23, Abraham allowed Lot to be autonomous. He went to greener pastures. And we find that he lost all of his followers. He ended up living in Sodom. He then lost his wife. And his two daughters couldn't find husbands. There are other splits in the Bible, in God's kingdom. You've got Ishmael and Isaac. You've got Esau and Jacob. Got Joseph from his brothers. So splits are nothing new. Things became so bad in the kingdom that by the time of the judges, it wasn't a split, there was a complete fracture of the kingdom, to the point where everybody was doing what they thought was right. In Judges 21:25, it says, in those days Israel had no king or no leader, and everybody did as they saw fit. God raised up a king, Saul, a figure to unify Israel so they could have a central leader again, like they did in the time of Abraham, Moses, and Joshua. Yet during this time, David was forced to be a catalyst of a split when his leader, King Saul, became ungodly and persecuted him for God favoring David. He persecuted him to the point of running him out of the kingdom. Yet God was with David in the minority and not Saul in the majority. Men saw this, and so there was a consistent trail of men leaving the majority, going over to being underneath the minority and David. You know, after Saul's death, the kingdom was split again. You have David, who inquires of the Lord in 2 Samuel 2, 1-3, he says, Lord, shall I go up to Judah? And he goes, yes, that's what you should do. And they make him king. And then Abner, the leader of the armies, made Ish-bosheth, Saul's son, king over Israel. But you don't see him asking God to do it. So in 2 Samuel 3, verse 1, you see this split. And it says, the war between the house of Saul and the house of David lasted a long time. David grew stronger and stronger, while the house of Saul grew weaker and weaker. Eventually, the kingdom was unified under the one leader, David, in 2 Samuel 5. After David came Solomon, under whom the kingdom was unified. But sin was allowed to creep into the kingdom. False doctrine, false gods were allowed into Israel. The desire for wealth and marrying of non-God believers, people from outside the kingdom. This was widespread from the king down. These sins led to another split in the kingdom of God. So in 1010, David was king of Judah. Then in 1003, David was king of Judah and Israel. There was unity. In 970, Solomon becomes king. And then in 930, the kingdom divides into the northern and southern kingdoms. This is the split that we're actually going to focus on and talk about the similarities that happen between us and the ICOC. We will see that this type of split is nothing new biblically. And Satan is our enemy, and we must fight for righteousness, true doctrine, and always being sold out or hot for God. So we turn to 1 Kings 11, verse 26. So we're actually going to talk about why the kingdom really split. Why did the ICOC really split? So in 1 Kings 11, 26. I'm going to talk about why the kingdom split at this time. It says, also, Jeroboam, son of Nebat, rebelled against the king. He was one of Solomon's officials, an Ephraite from Zerad, and his mother was a widow named Zerubbabel. Here is the account of how he rebelled against the king. Solomon had built the terraces and had filled in the gap in the wall of the city of David, his father. Now Jeroboam was a man of standing, and when Solomon saw how well the young man did his work, he put him in charge of the whole labor force of the tribes of Joseph. About that time, Jeroboam was going out of Jerusalem, and Haggai, the prophet of Shilon, met him on the way, wearing a new cloak. The two of them were alone in the country, and Haggai took hold of the new cloak he was wearing and tore it into 12 pieces. Then he said to Jeroboam, take 10 pieces for yourself, for this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. See, I am going to tear the kingdom out of Solomon's hand and give you 10 tribes. But for the sake of my servant David and the city of Jerusalem, which I have chosen out of all the tribes of Israel, he will have one tribe. I will do this because they have forsaken me and worship Ashereth, the goddess of the Sidonites, Chemosh, the god of the Moabites, and Molech, the god of the Ammonites, and have not walked in obedience to me, nor done what is right in my eyes, nor kept my decrees and laws as David, Solomon's father, did. But I will not take the whole kingdom out of Solomon's hands. I've made him ruler all the days of his life for the sake of David, my servant, whom I chose and who obeyed my commands and decrees. I will take the kingdom from the son's hand and give you 10 tribes. I will give one tribe to his son so that David, my servant, may always have a lamp before me in Jerusalem, the city where I chose to put my name. However, as for you, I will take you and you will rule over all your heart's desires. You will be king over Israel. If you do whatever I command you and walk in obedience to me and do what is right in my eyes by obeying my decrees and commands, and David my servant did, I will be with you. I will build you a dynasty as enduring as the one I built for David and will give Israel to you. I will humble David's descendants because of this, but not forever. Solomon tried to kill Jeroboam, but Jeroboam fled to Egypt, to Shishkar, the king, and stayed there until Solomon's death. So these events happened in the latter years of Solomon's reign, considered to be the glory years and the time of wealth. The temple is at its height, it's bathed in gold, and yet the spiritual condition of Israel was terrible from the inside. The leadership had tolerated sin and false doctrine. So what does God decide to do? God decides to split the kingdom because its leaders and its leader had tolerated sin in the kingdom. So does the split of the kingdom come about by the hand of God or by the hand of man? Well, here we see that God uses a man to split the kingdom. But it was the result of God working. He gives Jeroboam a chance to actually lead, but there are conditions. He needs to teach the commands of God and make the people obey them. In other words, that wasn't what Solomon was doing. We know in Matthew 28, 20, it's not about baptizing people, is it? It's about Matthew 28, 20, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you, and surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age. Amen. Teach them to obey, I'm with you. Don't teach them to obey, I'm not with you. Same principle all the way through the Bible. It's not simply hoping people obey, it's teaching them to obey. Right. This would take what we would call discipling, accountability, and discipline. Let's not, so where was the ICOC at before the split in 2003? Well, first of all, let's not forget that the ICOC came out of the mainland Church of Christ that believed in autonomy, that was its teaching, and did not believe in central leadership or discipling. So that's our history. In 1979, the average mainland Church of Christ had 150 members, with 8 people baptized a year, 6 were kids of members, and 90% of them fell away. That's our history. In 1979, 30 sold out would-be disciples decided to do something great in Boston, gathered in the Gemples living room, under the new leadership of Kip and Elena McKee. From that one church, 1979, in one nation, it grew in biblical proportions. In 1994, John Vaughan named the Boston movement the ICOC, International Churches of Christ, because of their impact globally. By 2001, the ICOC had a membership of 135,000, with 392 churches in 171 nations, half in the US and half international, having 40 churches with a membership of over 1,000. The largest was in Los Angeles with 10,000, and internationally, our largest was Manila with 6,000. This was compared to the mainland Churches of Christ, who in 1979 said that its largest church was within the US of 3,000 members, and its largest internationally was Nigeria with 500 members. In September of 2001, so 2003 is when the split happened, in September 2001, Kip and Elena McKean were asked to go on sabbatical because his daughter had fallen away. Most of us never knew that. And he never made another decision again in the ICOC. That was the end of Kip and Elena's influence in the ICOC. The kingdom teachers of the ICOC met and decided to take the doctrine of the ICOC back to the doctrine of the traditional Church of Christ, autonomy, and this was not told to the members. That was what they decided at the top. All of these ICOC teachers came from the mainland Church of Christ, including Gordon Ferguson, who believed in autonomous churches, and they obviously deep down had never repented of that false teaching, despite teaching against it. So Gordon Ferguson wrote a book in 1995, the edition of Prepare to Answer. There is a whole chapter on mainland or traditional Church of Christ. And to quote his book, it talks about, here's the mainland Church of Christ doctrine. It says church autonomy is God's plan for each congregation. And then he writes, the biblical truth, these are his words, such autonomy is neither biblical nor practical, as the extremely divided state of the mainland Church of Christ amply demonstrates. The one church of Ephesians 4:4 is the same universal church in which Christ put leaders for the purpose of maturing and united this one church, Ephesians 4:11-16. The leaders were linked together in their training and in their mission. So he actually taught publicly and in a book that you can still buy, the old edition, that autonomy was sin. So he went back against that.
Wow.
The doctrine and therefore the practices of the ICOC were changed over the period of 2001 to 2003. That was what actually happened by the kingdom teachers. They departed from the teaching of the whole truth and nothing but the truth, and teaching people to obey the scriptures. Nearly everybody did not understand this was going on. I was in the ministry in England, and I definitely didn't know this was going on. I didn't know Kip was on sabbatical or anything. Okay, and I was only Kip disciple Doug Arthur, Doug Arthur disciple Mark Templer, and Mark Templer disciple me. So we're only 4 ways down. So they did not notify the Christians. Discipling became optional, starting with the top leaders. So basically, Kip came out from discipling people, and then there was nobody to disciple them for a period, and rather than saying, okay, here's our new discipler, that wasn't chosen. And I will say something, because it's not in the notes, people say Kip was a dictator. I don't know who Kip was beforehand. But let me just encourage this. If he was a dictator, he wouldn't have resigned on sabbatical. And people forget that. Because dictators hold on to their power.
Yes.
Okay, so he didn't do that. Right, well, discipleship became optional, starting with the top leaders, while some still practiced it. Some did not. It all became objective, not being taught to obey. Central leadership, which originally was under Kip, was disbanded in favor of collective leadership. This theory was introduced very subtly in Gordon Ferguson's book, Golden Rule Leadership, Building a Team, a Spirit of Team and Family in the Body of Christ, published in 2001, but released in 2002. So 2001, Kip and Lehner went on sabbatical, the teachers took over, the book was released. In the United Kingdom, where we were main leaders, we weren't the main leaders, but we were senior leaders, this book was actually banned amongst the staff because the geographical center leader said, this is not right. Now, some staff members went, I'm still gonna go and buy it, and did. Okay. But you understand there was already a fracture there and a belief like a year later. So why did the kingdom actually split from a biblical point of view? The doctrine changed from the top down. False doctrine was introduced. And the false doctrine of a lack of discipling means that people then end up falling to all sorts of sin. Why? Because it's no longer taught to obey. So certain different people fall into different sins because the call is not for obedience. So from worldwide unity to autonomy. This was seen most notably very quickly in that people changed the name of their churches. So instead of being then called the International Sydney Church of Christ, a church would change its name to Sydney Church of Christ. Well, what does that sound like? It sounds like the mainland Church of Christ, because that's what they call themselves. So when you make a public declaration, we're changing our name, what's actually happening is you're withdrawing your fellowship and association with the International Christian Church, International Churches of Christ, the ICOC. So it then led to discipling being optional, little discipling, or in a lot of cases, no discipling. This term led to different doctrines coming into the worldwide movement, ranging from some meetings are optional, you can date people outside the kingdom. That was introduced roughly at least 2 months after we stopped leading Birmingham. The leader stood up and go, you can date people outside the kingdom. 2 months into 2003.
Wow.
Repentance and baptism not being essential for salvation. One of our evangelists was teaching that by February 2003.
Wow.
Okay. No accountability for evangelism. When people miss meetings, no one phones you up and tries to bring you back. Okay, because that's teaching them to obey. Evangelistic Bible talks and events go out the window because we're just dealing with our own internal issues. In short, all sorts of sin was allowed to creep in various churches and groups and left unchecked. To what degree that happened in any one group, I cannot comment. I was only in the churches. How long it took in any given group, I have no comment. But what actually happened was our doctrine changed, and that's why God brought about the split. That's why the church split. It's not because of personalities, it's not because of any of that. God may have used personalities, but the church from the top down started to teach a different doctrine, so God stepped in and went, bang. So when people say it was from God, absolutely it was from God, without doubt. Why you believe it was from God? Well, we all have different opinions because we all have different experiences. But that was actually what happened. The average Christian did not know this, and to this day, some people in the ICOC still do not know that that is exactly what happened.
Yeah.
Yes.
So, point number two.
What?
How did the split really happen? Now, this is where I do feel qualified to teach. Because Kerry and I led the Birmingham Church in England, which was about 320. Manchester was about 220. And then we had seven churches underneath us. We were in Henry Creek's D group in London when this happened, and the meltdown started really in London.
Wow.
So we're the only people I know of in the new movement that were actually there. So what gives us the ability to share this is that we were there.
Yes.
Kit was on sabbatical, so he views it from a different point of view because he was in a different position. But I'm actually going to tell you how it fell apart within 3 months. Okay? So go back to the scriptures and we'll see that this is nothing new because Satan uses the same ploys all the time. So 1 Kings 12, verse 1. It says, Rehoboam went to Shechem, for all Israel had gone there to make him king. So everybody had gone there to be unified, right? When Jeroboam, son of Nebat, heard this, he was still in Egypt, where he had fled from King Solomon. He returned from Egypt. So they went, sent for Jeroboam, and he and the whole assembly of Israel went to Rehoboam and said, your father put a heavy yoke on us, but now lighten the harsh labor and the heavy yoke he put on us, and we will serve you. Rehoboam answered, go away for 3 days and then come back to me. So the people went away. Then King Rehoboam consulted with the elders who had served his father, Solomon, during his lifetime. How would you advise me to answer these people, he asked. He replied, if today you will be a servant to these people and serve them and give them a favorable answer, they will always be your servants. But Rehoboam rejected the advice the elders gave him and consulted young men who had grown up with him and were serving him. He asked them, what is your advice? How should you answer these people who say to me, lighten the yoke your father put on us? The young men who had grown up with him replied, these people have said to you, your father put a heavy yoke on us, make our yoke lighter. Now tell them, my little finger is thicker than my father's waist. My father laid on you a heavy yoke. I will make it even heavier. My father scourged you with whips. I will scourge you with scorpions. 3 days later, Jeroboam and all the people returned to Rehoboam, as the king had said. Come back to me in 3 days. The king answered the people harshly, rejecting the advice given to him by the elders. He followed the advice of the young people and said, my father made your yoke heavy, I will make it even heavier. My father scourged you with whips, I will scourge you with scorpions. So the king did not listen to the people, for this turn of events was from the Lord, to fulfill the word the Lord had spoken to Jeroboam, son of Nebat, to Ahijah the Shilonite. When all Israel saw the king refused to listen to them, they answered the king, what share do we have in David? What part is Jesse's sons to your tents, Israel? Look after your own house, David. So the Israelites went home, but as for the Israelites who were living in the towns of Judah, Rehoboam still ruled over them. King Rehoboam sent Adoram, who was in charge of forced labor, but all Israel stoned him to death. King Rehoboam, however, managed to get into his chariot and escape to Jerusalem. So Israel has been in rebellion against the house of David to this day. When all the Israelites heard that Jeroboam had returned, they sent and called him to the assembly and made him king over all Israel. Only the tribe of Judah remained loyal to the house of David. When Rehoboam arrived in Jerusalem, he mustered all Judah and the tribe of Benjamin, 180,000 able men, to go to war against Israel and to regain the kingdom for Rehoboam, son of Solomon. But the word of the Lord came to Shema, the man of God, say to Rehoboam, son of Solomon, king of Judah, to all Judah and Benjamin and the rest of the people, this is what the Lord says. Do not go up to fight against your brothers, the Israelites. Go home, every one of you, for this is my doing. So they obeyed the word of the Lord and went home again as the Lord had ordered. So the setting of this passage was right after Solomon had died in 930 BC. We've seen from the previous passage that the spiritual state of Israel was terrible. So what made the split? Man or God? Well, in one sense, it was Rehoboam's harshness. This, from a human point of view, was the catalyst. But then you might say it was the older people's response, because they lacked patience underneath the new king. They refused to give him time to learn and to change from his mistakes. You could say it was Jeroboam's selfish ambition. You see, as he was told he would be king over the northern kingdoms, he didn't respond in the way that David did. David was told he was going to be king, but he was humble and he waited for Saul to be taken out by God.
Yeah, right.
Whereas Jeroboam arrives and goes, here I am, and he pushes the issue. He doesn't let God do it. It actually says all these events were from the Lord. As God is sovereign and either allows something to happen or to make it happen, it's all from God. He was working through the character of the people he was given, and he used those characters to get his will achieved. He allowed the split of the kingdom to punish those in it because of their sin of not holding to the teachings of God's word and not making the people obey them. Their compromise to the scriptures led God to action. In other words, if you as the leaders are not going to deal with it, I will deal with it.
Come on.
So, did Rehoboam's harshness cause hurt to his people? Well, yes. Yet when God's word was used on Rehoboam, he actually did repent.
Yeah.
One thing to note here is that also that Rehoboam was left in charge of Judah and the temple where God resided. That was where God was residing, in the temple, yeah, in the Holy of Holies. So in 1 Kings 14:21 it says, Rehoboam, son of Solomon, was king in Judah. He was 41 years old when he became king, and he reigned 17 years in Jerusalem, the city the Lord had chosen out of all the tribes of Israel in which to put his name. His mother's name was Naaman, and she was an Ammonite. So how did the split actually happen in 2003? Okay. So Kip and Elena went, as central leaders, went on sabbatical in 2001. The kingdom teachers that were all from the traditional Church of Christ assumed the main influence. Gordon Ferguson released his book, The Golden Rule Leadership, in 2002. Many read it, and this has a real influence of collective leadership. Then, ironically, there was a meeting held called the Unity Meeting. See in this passage how they all came together and they were going to be unified and make the guy king? This was held in Long Beach in Los Angeles in late 2002. Where the senior leaders of the ICOC confirmed that they would become an autonomous group of churches rather than an international unified group. They would not replace KIPP, they would not have a central leader. Basically, the world sector leaders didn't need discipling, they were mature enough to just go and lead things on their own. So then what happened was, our main leaders in the United Kingdom came back. We were leading Birmingham. We'd actually just had a really great year. You know, sometimes in church you have great years, sometimes it'd been a really great year. We came down to the staff meeting before Christmas, that last staff meeting. It's all great. You give each other's Christmas presents. It's fantastic. I wasn't even aware that there was a unity meeting going on. Remember, there are only four levels to where we were at.
Yeah.
So we arrive at the staff meeting, normal staff meeting. At the end of the staff meeting, 10 minutes on this unity meeting. We drove back up to Birmingham. Great, it's Christmas, we're all going to have fun, etc. So our staff meetings, I'm fairly sure, were on a Tuesday. I got a call, it must have been the Wednesday or Thursday, it went, no, we need another meeting to discuss what went on in LA. So I drove down to London, really did not have a clue what was going on. Walked into what would later be known as an open forum system, which was just, we're in a room and let's talk it. I don't know if that was the forum in LA, I'm sure somebody out there may know or not, but that's what I walked into. What I then walked into is this. Well, bro, you did this and I've never really got on with you and you've done this and...
Yeah.
I was furious because my main leader, his right-hand guy, who had portrayed complete unity in those staff meetings, and we're all happy and fun, went, well, I've never agreed with this. I remember being incredibly upset, you know I'm a crier, and just going, I don't get this. You guys aren't unified. And they, as the sort of senior leaders, and we had, this is where Henry Creek was there, who was a senior leader in Africa at one point, and in London we actually had, just in the ministry, not only senior leaders, but some ex-senior leaders in the ministry. And so I was sort of left going, you guys just need to resolve this. This is, you know, we're outside the church and we've just had a great year. And so I was caught a bit off guard. We then went for Christmas. Everybody went home for Christmas and to their own families, etc. We then traditionally had a UK-wide unified staff meeting, which we would then have before we did our January workshop. I don't think we called them January workshop, but our, you know, then we just called them family group leaders meetings, 1st of January. So instead of going to this meeting, which was two nights away, and it being a lesson on prayer and a lesson on evangelism, we're going to do this and this and this, we walked into the room, and it was just an open forum, which was, what do we want to hear, and what are we doing here, and what are we doing here, and what are we doing here, I disagree with this. The right-hand guy of the whole of the UK refused to come. So he just went to his room. So I don't know if he'd seen something in LA, but that was it. And basically what happened was, the leader at the time in England was Mark Templer. And I was assigned with Mark Templer. As every Christian, he has issues, but I'll tell you one thing this about Mark Templer. He's always been an exceptional Christian. And if you're listening, Mark, very proud. What happened was, it then basically became, do we agree that Mark is our leader? That was the undercurrent. What happened then was, we were then asked, okay, well, let's split off into groups and discuss these issues. And we literally, so imagine this group is, I don't know, 80. I can't, there must have been 80 people there at the retreat. It literally was, okay, this six of friends that had the same issues went into this room and discussed. It was a fracture. It was a division. I do remember going into a room with Mark. I love Mark, and as with all leaders, if I led here long enough, you'd have issues with my style. So would I have liked him to be more like Jesus? Of course I would. Okay. Don't you want me to be more like Jesus? In other words, we've all got issues, right?
Yeah.
This is the total opposite to Matthew 18:15, which says, if your brother or sister sins, go and point out their fault just between the two of you. If they listen to you, you've won them over. But if they will not listen, take two or three along with them, so that every matter may be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. That is how you resolve things. Does it take more time? Yes. But open forums are not in the Bible. Okay. So, then what happened was, we all left a bit confused, went back to our churches, and came back for the, what you would call a January workshop. So, Birmingham drove down to London. They were normally held on a Friday, Saturday or Sunday night. Mike Fontenot was our guest speaker. So a great Bible Talk Leaders workshop, we're going to do this, it's great, normal launch. Mike preached, I can't remember what he preached on, but almost probably had between 500 and 800 people in it. And then, after talk, rather than just being responses, people went, well, I've heard this is going on. And so it pretty much hijacked the meeting. Because what happened, you see, now that the staff were allowed to discuss everything, well, they went back and told their friends, the Bible Talk Leaders now wanted to discuss everything, now everybody wanted to discuss everything openly. That's what was happening. At this stage, it hadn't fractured and there wasn't people leaving. But what was introduced was this concept of open forums. So, stupidly on my part, I can say that now, we went back to Birmingham. We had an open forum. Okay. Which meant that anybody could say anything. One sister, and not only that, the staff could say nothing. So I was sitting down here at the front, and it didn't matter what anybody said, I was not allowed to refute anything that was said. One sister stood up and said, I've heard the leadership has led pedophiles in the church. I was not allowed to refute it. Guess how many sisters with kids came on Sunday? Hardly anybody. People stopped paying the contribution. That's the first thing people withheld. And the church always runs on that tight budget, like, have we got enough money to pay our staff? Because we're always trying to employ as many staff as possible without stretching ourselves. So if 10 people, good givers, stop giving, then that's a real struggle. Now the implosion happens. There is no money to hire the staff. People are withholding it. People are either taking off staff or resigning. Did everybody get a severance? Well, you can't give money if you haven't got the money. And basically, this is where the implosion happened. Henry Crete wrote an email. Okay. He never wrote a letter. Never did. Henry, basically what happened was, he had written a great book called Worship the King, previously. It was a great book. It's a really great book. So, you see a guy that's written a great book, you go, he's of influence. Henry Crete had been in our D group for a year. He wrote an email to some of his friends. Now, because he'd been around a long time, he had a lot of friends, but it was to his friends. I know he didn't write it to everybody because he didn't email it to me, and I was in his knee group. So there's no way he wrote a letter to everybody. He basically, and if you actually read it now, it's fairly harmless. It's pretty much, guys, there were some issues, we need to be a bit more humble, etc., etc. People then grabbed this and went, look, if Henry believes it, it must be true. So rather than going, I have also, this is my conviction, it was using this to go, look, Henry has said. In my view, that was cowardice. But by now, financially, the kingdom was imploding. What is the impact on that third world? Guess who supports all the third worlds? The first world. If we can't hire the first world, we're not going to send money to the third world. The first people to come were the foreign missionaries, okay, that went back. And then, so that ripple happened all around the world to some degree. In some areas, that happened really quick. In some, that didn't happen for many years. Okay. All I can now say is what happened to us. So we were leading Birmingham and the other churches. We came off staff. We'd actually planned a holiday. So remember, this all happened December 2002, January 2003. We'd planned a holiday and paid for a holiday to come over and see Kerry's family in February. So we came over to Australia, and we went to the church there in Brisbane. And what was really amazing was, I got with people and went, we heard in England, this has happened, and this has happened. I went, that's really interesting. I was in all of those meetings, and I can tell you that is not what happened. So a month later, the other side of the world, what people were being told happened, and what actually happened was very, very different. We tried to stem the flow as much as we could by getting with people, but even in that church, some of the, I'll be honest, bitter older Christians that had been taken out of leadership saw it as their opportunity to rah. Okay? We then returned to England. What happened to us, I don't know if it happened to other people. We were definitely even persecuted by people at our church. We had people come to our house, attack our family, attack our four-year-old daughter. I mean, it got pretty nasty, but I feel like that's just Satan, that's not people. Do you know what I mean? We then decided to emigrate, okay? We spoke to various different people. Some churches would welcome us, and some churches as ex-ministers would not welcome us. So we were not welcome at some of the ICOC churches at that moment in time. That's how bad it got, okay? So that was basically what happened. We actually had some struggles with our visa and ended up back in Australia, Brisbane, in September of 2003. The day we arrived, the Brisbane church had just split into two churches. We chose to go with one rather than the other for no reason than there's two churches and we need to go with. Okay. So what really surprised me though was how quickly some of the doctrine changed. So what I thought was a great leader in our church and had been leading churches in England quite some time said, I no longer believe in baptism for the forgiveness of sins. 2 months after the meltdown, I was just like, that to me was a shock. So there were already, obviously, some undergrounding doctrines that we didn't really believe in that were subjugated then. What you see about the split in the Bible here is, it was Israel and Judah, the same split between David and the house of Saul beforehand. So that it was already there. It just had never been resolved. So that's what actually happened. What happened in everybody else's situation is all a little bit different. And this brings me to my third point. What happened after the split? So I need to apologize for, at the time, in 2003, I didn't stand my ground. I didn't really know what was going on. There's no excuse for that. I've got a Bible. I could have done a lot better in that situation. So what happened after split? Well, going back to the scriptures in 1 Kings 12, 25, so what happened to Jeroboam? Did he become a great godly leader? Did he obey God's word as God had instructed him? I mean, after all, he was left with the majority of the kingdom, right? So in the ICOC, there was still a large part of it left. And in 1 Kings 12, 25, it says, Then Jeroboam fortified in Shechem in the hill country of Ephraim and lived there. From there he went out to build up Peniel. Jeroboam thought to himself, the kingdom will now likely revert to the house of David. If these people go up to offer sacrifices at the temple of the Lord in Jerusalem, they will again give their allegiance to the Lord, Rehoboam, king of Judah. They will kill me and return to King Rehoboam. After seeking advice, the king made two golden calves. He said to the people, it is too much for you to go up to Jerusalem. Here are your gods, Israel, who brought you up out of Egypt. One he set up in Bethel and the other in Dan. And this thing became a sin. The people came to worship the one in Bethel and went as far as Dan to worship the other. Jeroboam built shrines on the high places and appointed priests from all sorts of people, even though they were not Levites. He instituted a festival on the 15th day of the 8th month, like the festival held in Judah, and offered sacrifices on the altar. This he did in Bethel, sacrificing to the calves he had made. And at Bethel he also installed priests at the high places he had made. On the 15th day of the 8th month, a month of his own choosing, he offered sacrifices on the altar he had built at Bethel. So he instituted the festivals for the Israelites and went up to the altar to make the offerings. So what was the first thing Jeroboam did? He fortified his own personal position as a leader. He was insecure of losing his new position as a leader, therefore he fortified and he tried to keep his brothers away from their brothers. He went, you're not allowed to associate with them. Ring any bells?
Oh.
He got see, it's nothing new. It's nothing new.
Right.
He got advice from those around him, which was bad advice. But these were the former leaders. Yeah, but they gave bad advice now. He tried to win the people by lessening their commitment level, saying they did not need to go to Jerusalem, to the temple in Jerusalem, to sacrifice and worship. It's nothing new. Then he promoted people worshipping other things than God, careers, etc. He appointed unqualified leaders who had no place leading. In some cases, ex-traditional Church of Christ leaders, and in one case I know of, people started going to Baptist conferences instead of even the ICOC conferences. Yeah. He instituted similar festivals or doctrines as the one prescribed by God. So, but different, in order to promote the lack of adherence to scriptural festivals. So we'll do similar things, but it's not really what we should be doing. Jeroboam created a form of godliness instead of actual godliness. Remember, this happened in the early church under the apostles. 2 Timothy 3:1-5, it says, in the last days there will be a form of God. It happened in the early church.
Right.
So why was it such a big surprise to us? So this pattern should not be a surprise. But what was the outcome for Jeroboam? Well, in 1 Kings 13, verse 1, it says, by the word of the Lord, a man of God came from Judah to Bethel as Jeroboam was standing by the altar to make an offering. By the word of the Lord, he cried out against the altar, altar, altar. This is what the Lord says. A son named Josiah will be born to the house of David. On you he will sacrifice the priests of the high places who make offerings here, and human bones will be burned on you. That same day the man of God gave a sign. This is the sign the Lord has declared. The altar will be split apart, and the ashes on it will be poured out. He says the kingdom of David, Judah, the part which they had split off from, would be used to destroy them, the majority.
Wow.
Yet even after this rebuke, he never changed his ways. 1 Kings 13:33 says, even after this, Jeroboam did not change his evil ways, but once more appointed priests for the high places from all sorts of people. Anyone who wanted to become a priest, he consecrated for high places. This was the sin of the house of Jeroboam that led to his downfall and to its destruction from the face of the earth. They instituted leaders that taught false doctrine, people that weren't trained in the ministry and had no place being there. They pulled from the ranks, and anybody could do whatever they led, as long as they were willing. What was the reaction of this? Of those in the kingdom of Israel that still wanted to seek God. So what, okay, so you've got Rehoboam and Jerusalem, Jeroboam broken off. But what about his people? I mean, we're his people, right? We're in it. Yeah. Forget the leaders, I'm not really interested. What happened to the people?
Come on.
And is that where our heart is? What about the people?
Yes.
Well, 2 Chronicles 11, verse 5. Says, Rehoboam lived in Jerusalem and built up towns for the defense in Judah. Bethlehem, Etam, Tekoa, Bethzura, Soko, Dullam, Gath, Marash, Ziphas, Adurim, Lachish, Zika, Zora, Adonai, and Hebron. Sorry, they're obviously not right. Again. Okay. These are the fortified cities in Judah and Jerusalem, Benjamin. He strengthened their defenses and put commanders in them with supplies of food, olive oil, and wine. He put shields and spears in all the cities and made them very strong. So Judah and Benjamin were his, two tribes. The priests and the Levites from all their districts throughout Israel sided with him. The Levites even abandoned their pasture lands and property and came to Judah and Jerusalem because Jeroboam and his sons had rejected them as the priests of the Lord when he appointed his own priests for the high places, for the goat and the calf idols he made. Those from every tribe of Israel who set their hearts on seeking the Lord, the God of Israel, followed the Levites to Jerusalem to offer sacrifices to the Lord, the God of their ancestors. They strengthened the kingdom of Judah and supported Rehoboam, son of Solomon, 3 years, following the ways of David and Solomon during this time. The Levites, the staff, left Israel and went back and placed themselves underneath the once harsh leader, Rehoboam. And everybody that was really seeking God went back. You see, Rehoboam had learned a big lesson. He had been harsh. Yet here we see him generously supplying the towns out of his own pocket. He's giving it. He's now building up with the leaders, giving them food, oil, wine, equipment. He had transformed from a harsh, selfish leader to now a benevolent leader. Were we harsh in the old movement? Yes, I was just thinking myself. The issue is not were we harsh, the issue is did we learn?
Yeah.
So I know Kim said we're exactly like the ICOC in the early days, but prayerfully we've just become more loving and more kind and more wise. So he had learned. And as a result, the Levites went, we're coming back. So, what happened in each ICOC from 2003 to now is different. I have no comment on that. I was not in every church. Some ICOC churches simply do not exist anymore. There are some countries where we had multiple churches where there are no ICOC churches anymore. This is very, very sad, and the only person that is laughing and jumping for joy is Satan, because I surely am. But we must remember, he is our enemy. To again quote Gordon Ferguson, who was one of the main instigators and change to autonomy in the ICOC between 2001 and 2002, he wrote, referring to what is now the ICOC in 2006 in his book, that My Three Lives, the Story of One Man and Three Movements. So he wrote this at the end of 2015. He says, we had 666 congregations overall, 381 of which baptized between 1 and 10 people, and 122 had zero baptisms. Thus, in our 667 churches, 503, that's 75%, baptized between 0 and 10 people in a year. And let me state the obvious here, when 75% of our congregations are baptized between 0 and 10 people per year, things are not close to going well. That is what he said. So what's happened? Well, some of the former ministry, like the Levites, have figured it out and have started to join the ICC, myself included, Oliver included. Where do we see that? It's exactly the same. Many who sought to seek God with all their heart have come back to the once harsh leadership that prayerfully has learned not to be harsh. God is gathering the disciples that he scattered, growing it into a movement that in the last 11 years has seen 85 churches. Let me help you understand that. If you could plant, even just from this room, and say, guys, here's a plan. Now, 11 years, we're going to plant 85 churches across the world. There's no way you could do it. There's no way you could plan for that. That doesn't happen by man. Jeremiah 23:3 says, this is God speaking, I myself will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the countries where I have driven them and will bring them back to their pasture where they will be fruitful and increase in numbers. Much fruit has always been a sign of a true disciple. John 15:8. That doesn't mean every church that is growing is of God.
Amen.
But it does mean a movement of God needs to be growing.
Amen.
Satan has attacked us, and God has allowed the demise of the former movement. We see this pattern of God scattering his remnant and then gathering it to rebuild his worldwide unified movement. We were gathered from Brisbane, went over to LA, we trained, we planted the Sydney church, now the Hong Kong church, now we're involved in Cambodia, and we're here with you today.
Amen. Woo!
Truth and grace.
Yes.
Grace and truth.
Yes.
You apply grace first, the truth is easier to get. Are the people in the sold out movement or ICC perfect? Right in everything? Not making mistakes? No. Why have there been so many failures? Well, Satan attacks. But one of the other things is, in the first temple, it was bathed in gold, used with many, many great stones quarried. The second temple was actually made with the rubble that was used from a fire. Now, I was brought up on a pig farm and we had a fire. And what actually happens is I actually had to clean it up when I was 16. And you put all the bricks to one side that look good. Some of them are a bit charred and you clean them off. Some are sort of half damaged and you break them. And some just look good and you put them all to a side. And then the new builder comes in and goes, look, we've got good bricks, and he uses them. But what you don't realize is that those bricks are incredibly damaged, some of them. But you can't, if you're not an expert builder, you don't know that.
Right.
So you put that brick in a wall, you put some more pressure, some more bricks on it, and some of those bricks suddenly go poof, and then become powder. That's us remnant.
Oh.
We're damaged from the inside out.
Right.
And you put pressure on us, and sometimes people leave, sometimes realize they're not as strong, which is very humbling. But we're building with rubble here. We're not building with glory, we're building with rubble.
Right.
So it's to be expected, not happy about it. What is the difference? Well, we believe, I've never stopped believing what I believed when I was baptized. Our five convictions. We're a Bible church, not simply a New Testament church. Why? What have I just been teaching you? The Old Testament.
Right.
If you've been reading our Old Testament, we go, it was nothing new. But those that only focus on the New Testament, boy, are we missing out.
Yeah.
Be silent where the Bible speaks and speak where the Bible is silent. It got really weird where we were. Well, why do we take communion? We didn't actually have services in Australia because we needed to discuss how to take communion. Sitting around the middle, I'm like, sheesh. Now we're double guessing everything.
Yeah.
No, there's no word Bible talk leader in the Bible. You can't call it a Bible talk. You can't call it Kingdom Kids. Because I don't see kingdom. It just got weird. We're a discipling movement. We believe in teaching to obey.
Yeah.
Who wants to be discipled in their marriage? Thank you! One of the sad things was how many divorces happened really, really quickly. We believe in a central leadership. With a central leader. These are our five core convictions. You can find them on our website. So why did the kingdom split? Why did it really split? God split it because we fell into sin as a movement.
Right.
Yeah.
And people like me let it happen. You go, well, I didn't know what I was doing. That's true. But did I stand up and go, open forums are a sin? No, I didn't. I allowed it to happen in my church and I paid the price. So that's my responsibility.
Awesome.
How did the split really happen? Well, we were there. So I feel like we're qualified. Maybe I'm not perfect in every detail, but I'll tell you, I know a lot more than most people. What happened after split? Well, there are two movements. They believe very different things. So the ICOC, and the ICC now have very different teachings. Its leaders teach very different things. While some members in the ICOC hold on to teachings. So we visited our friends in our old church of Birmingham, the guys at the bottom, they still believed in all the worldwide unity and everything like that, but they didn't know what was changing at the top. So while we have similar teachings, we do not believe the same thing totally. The ICC, our movement, prayerfully God's movement, if we keep humble and righteous, is a globally unified movement of churches with the same doctrine all over the world, sharing finances, sharing resources, sharing staff, supporting each other in the goal of global salvation. The ICOC is not. There can be no emotional unity between two groups when there is no scriptural, biblical, spiritual unity. We can never be unified. The only thing that will unify us is if we both believe the same thing. The difference in their impact globally is radically different. I leave you with these three scriptures that Jesus teaches you can know whether people are his or not. And these are all from John. It's what I like to call Jesus' discipleship study. This is what you'll know if somebody's a disciple. John 8, 31 to 32. Jesus says, to the Jews who had believed in me, Jesus said, if you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. John 13, 34, 35. A new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. And John 15, 8, this is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourself to be my disciples. These scriptures are to be applied personally, on a group level, on a church level, and on a worldwide movement level. And they're what judge us, and you now need to make your own decision who is a true disciple and who is not a true disciple. Amen.